morning. Welcome to Life in Christ. It's so good to see everyone here today as we gather together in God's house and lift up our prayers to our loving Heavenly Father, sing His praises, remember all that He has done for us, and then we also hear God's great invitation today to live our lives loving our neighbor as ourself. And so we hear the parable of the Good Samaritan who went out of his way for a neighbor in need. And we hear about how God does that for us, and He invites us to do that for others. So glad to see you all here. It's also a special day because we are installing a couple of new elders. And we also are sending off our National Youth Gathering group. And so we have a group of nine that is going to take a flight to Minneapolis, and we're going to spend a week in Minneapolis with 25,000 other youth from throughout the country, and we're just going to have a good time and learn about Jesus, and just really looking forward to this, and I pray that it's a blessing for our youth. In your bulletin, there is an opening prayer. Please turn to that, and as you are able, please stand, and we will pray. We pray together. Heavenly Father, You restored Your people to eternal life by raising Christ Jesus from the dead and grave. Make our faith strong and our hope sure. Prepare our hearts to receive Your gifts of grace in today's worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May God bless our time here this morning. Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to Your unfailing love.
According to Your great compassion, blot out all my iniquity.
Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me.
Against You, You only, have I sinned and done what is evil in Your sight.
Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit.
Let us confess our sins to God, looking to the cross of Jesus for forgiveness and healing. Father in heaven, I am a poor, miserable sinner. Mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Goodness, mercifully look upon your people, that we may be governed and preserved evermore in body and soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading today comes from Isaiah chapter 66, verses 10 through 14. I will extend peace to her like a river. Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her, all you who love her. Rejoice with her in joy, all you who mourn over her, that you may nurse and be satisfied from her consoling breast, that you may drink deeply with delight from her glorious abundance. For thus says the Lord, behold, I will extend peace to her like a river, and the glory of the nations like an overflowing stream. And you shall nurse. You shall be carried upon her hip and bounced upon her knees. As one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. You shall see, and your heart shall rejoice. Your bones shall flourish like the grass, and the hand of the Lord shall be known to his servants, and he shall show his indignation against his enemies. The epistle lesson comes from Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 through 10 and 14 through 18. Bear one another's burdens. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. For each will have to bear his own load. One who is taught the word must share all good things with the one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever one sows, that will he will also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption, but the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. But far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. For neither circumcision counts for anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. And as for all who walk by this rule, peace and mercy be upon them and upon the Israel of God. From now on, let no one cause me trouble, for I bear on my body the marks of Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit, brothers. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As you are able, please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Gospel this morning comes from St. Luke, the 10th chapter, the parable of the Good Samaritan. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put Jesus to the test, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus said to him, What is written in the law? How do you read it? And he answered, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live. But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, And who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place, and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, Take care of him, and whatever you spend, I will repay you when I come back. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? He said, The one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, You go and do likewise. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We joyfully and boldly confess the Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess together, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
A congregation can be seated, and at this time, children are invited to come forward for a message, to come sit up front. I see a whole bunch of them running there from the back. This is great. All right. You all are so fast. Wow. Oh, no. Are you okay? There's a spot. You can go. Sure, there you go. So, guys, summer so far. Yeah, everyone? Okay, awesome. You have been had a good summer? Yeah. You got your toenails done. That's yeah. That's really cool. It's they're not just colors. They have like it's a flower. That's awesome. Excellent. Who else has had a good summer so far? Yeah. What's made your summer good? Wisconsin. Oh, that's cool. Yeah. Very good. Wisconsin. Yeah, and I think you know what? I think I've seen that you've gone to a few baseball games too. Yeah, that's really fun. Yeah, cool. All right, Patrick, what's been good with your summer? Camping. All right, in Arizona here. Yeah, up north. All right, fun. Cool. That's something I've never done here in Arizona. I did a lot of it in Minnesota, but not here. You. Okay. Yeah, my kids haven't really either. So. Okay, so one of the things I summer and used to like about summer is reading books. And I was about one of my favorite children's authors. Okay, and I'm going to show you a picture, and you can tell me if you figure out who this author is. Okay, and I realize it's black and white here, but Doc, that's Cat in the Hat. And so Patrick said it right. It's Dr. Seuss. Okay. That's his writing name. Yeah. Okay. And so who are these characters? Thing one. Yeah, it says right on their shirts. But thing one and thing two. Yeah, they're pretty fun in Dr. Seuss and Cat in the Hat. And you know what? But I want to show you one more Dr. Seuss character. Who's this one? Horton. Yeah. Horton, here's a who. Yeah, it's a book. They made a movie out of it. And actually, I want to talk to you about the story Horton Hears a Who. And so there's this elephant named Horton, and he is something. There's a piece of dust that kind of flies by, and Horton hears some noise from this little thing that's just flying through the air. And What did he hear? What was the noise? Who was making the noise? The who's, and it was it just one who? It was like a whole bunch of them. It was like their own little world. Yeah, it's just tiny, yeah, and they were worried because they're flying through the air, and they're worried that they're gonna land in the water, and then they're all gonna like. It's not going to be good. They're all going to drown, yes. And so, but Horton hears this who, and he decides, you know what, I'm going to take care of, I'm going to protect these who's. Okay? And so throughout the whole book, throughout the whole movie, he's doing all that he can to protect all these who's. And some of the other animals actually make fun of him, like, Horton, why are you caring about this little speck of dust and these little people and whatever? Yes, what did you want to say, Brooklyn? Yeah, that's very nice of Horton, isn't it? Yeah. Well, so, and these other animals are kind of like making fun of him and not treating him very well, but Horton says something really good that we all can remember today. He says, a person is a person no matter how small. Okay? And in our reading today, our story about Jesus, I'm going to revise that thing. And what I think Jesus wants us to know and he invites us to learn today is that a neighbor is a neighbor no matter how small. And so all people that are around us, they are our neighbors. And so Jesus tells this story about a guy who's traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he comes across some robbers, and they actually hurt him, and they leave him beside the side of the road. And then more travelers are going on this road. There's a priest and there's a Levite, and they see this guy injured on the side of the road. And what do the priest and the Levite do? Did anyone pick that up from the...
They just walked past.
They just left. You're right. Yeah. Yeah, very, very good. Yeah, so they don't do anything. And then this Samaritan comes, and what does the Samaritan do? He helps him. Yeah, he goes over to the injured man. He binds up his wounds. He puts him on his animal. He takes him off to an inn. He gives the innkeeper money. He says, take care of this guy. Make him better. If it's going to cost any more money, I'll pay it to you when I come back. He does everything he can to help this stranger because the stranger is in need. And the point that Jesus is trying to make is that all of those around us, when we see a need, someone who is in trouble or needs some help, that Jesus invites us to love that person like he loves them and to help them. And so a neighbor is a neighbor, no matter how small. All right, well, thank you very much. You guys are awesome. You know all kinds of of the details of the Horton Hears a Who story. Just out of curiosity, what are some other Dr. Seuss books? Do you guys know some other Dr. Seuss books? One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish. Anyone else? What are some other, what's a Dr. Seuss book you like? Sam I Am, yeah, with the Green Eggs and Ham. You'd Rather Be a Bullfrog. Fox and Socks. There's all kinds of fun ones. So maybe today you want to go home and, I know you guys, some of you are kind of old, pull out a Dr. Seuss book or another book and have some fun time reading. Let's go ahead and pray. I invite you to repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for this happy day. Thank you for all that you have done for us. Thank you for your love and compassion. Help us to love others and be compassionate and help those in need. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. All right, thank you so much for coming forward. You can head on back to your seats.
Thank you.
God is love, and we need his love more than we need food and water. And God himself wants us to experience his love and then share it with others. God's love in action, in and through us, is one of the great joys and purposes of life. On the race of faith, the Holy Spirit empowers us to show the love of Jesus to others. You can't be a person who loves somebody else without thinking about that person's struggles, pain, joys, and sorrows, and supporting them. That's why Jesus changed the focus in our gospel reading this morning from the question that was asked, which is, who is my neighbor, to the better question, who can I be a neighbor to? The interesting thing about the priest and the Levite in the parable of the Good Samaritan is that they were technically right, but lovingly wrong. You see, they had a law that said that you couldn't touch a dead body. And so they're traveling along the road and they see somebody who is mortally wounded and something bad's going on there with this guy on the side of the road. And they can justify their action of continuing to go forward because they say, hey, I can't go near that dead body. It might, that guy there might be dead. They miss the point. The point of the law is that we love others as God loves us. By ignoring the man in need, they missed the point of God's law. You and I miss the point with God too, don't we? We miss the point when we know of a person who's different than us, and we fail to think that, well, I can't approach that person or befriend that person. I don't want him. We miss the point when we see a coworker who is sad and we don't want to take the time to go and talk. We maybe justify it in our own minds and say, ah, they don't have the time to talk anyway. Or we miss the point when we're too busy to call our parents. Maybe we miss the point when we listen to others who tell us that you're not cool unless you indulge in drugs and alcohol and premarital sex. It's easy to assume the wrong things about life, to stick to our self-driven, self-centered schedules, doing what we and everybody else but God wants us to do, to walk on the other side of the road when someone is in need. It's comfortable to keep things convenient, in order, and predictable. Just keep swimming. But in doing it, we aren't walking in the way of love. On January 13th, 1982, Air Florida Flight 90 experienced the worst you can imagine. It was taking off. There was some ice on the wings. It was wintry weather. And the plane plunged into the Potomac River. Almost all of the passengers died. But as shocked onlookers saw this scene, and they saw the tail of the plane sticking up out of the water, they noticed there were some survivors. And so, of course, they did everything they could. They really couldn't do a lot. But then the rescue helicopter came. As this is all going on, the news is capturing these unspeakable events. And they witnessed a great act of compassion. Arland Williams grabbed the cord that came down from the rescue helicopter, but he didn't put it around himself. He passed it to someone else, Kelly Duncan. The helicopter returned later. Once again, Arland grabbed the cord. This time, he passed it off to Joe Stilley. The helicopter came again. By this time, it was too late for Arland. He sacrificed his life so that strangers could live. That's showing Jesus' love to others. That's inconvenient compassion, not walking forward, but seeing the need and responding. That's love that is right on time, bringing real blessings right in the midst of struggle and hopelessness. Compassion in action when the person really needs it. Jesus described the Samaritan, who similarly stopped everything and went and helped the wounded guy on the road. The Samaritan had things to do. The road from Jerusalem to Jericho was not a road that vacationers took on their way to their great vacation. No, the Samaritan had business to do. But he chose to not stick to the clock and instead walked in love. Samaritans, as you probably know, weren't well regarded by Jesus' listeners. And so it's shocking to them that this Samaritan would do this, that he, of all people, would be the one to follow God's command and invitation to love others. But the point was loud and clear in the parable. The Samaritan was the one who took his time, spent his money, went the extra distance, and took a big risk. And Jesus encourages us, commands us that that is the way to live life. The expert in the law, Jesus asks, which one of these three was a neighbor to the man in need? The lawyer had to say the third guy. And then Jesus says something that puts all of our excuses aside when we see someone in need. He said, go and do likewise. Live a life of mercy, compassion, and grace right on time for others. Pray that God use you for his purposes. Nourish your faith daily, weekly, and as the Holy Spirit burns inside of you, he will guide you to share the love with others. In the midst of the Flight 90 tragedy, it wasn't just the rescue helicopter that actually succeeded in rescuing people. There's another incident. And this incident involved a Congressional Budget Office assistant who could see all that was going on in the Potomac, and he saw a woman, Priscilla, that appeared to go under after she was fighting for a while. And he decided to jump into action. He took off his winter coat, he took off his boots, and he jumped into the Potomac, and he was successful in bringing her back to shore. He showed the love of Jesus. He responded to a need. And in doing so, he saved a precious life. That's the way that right on time compassion is. And we, like Priscilla, all have times when we need it. Don't we? Now, we're not in the icy waters of the Potomac. But does it ever feel like you're in the icy waters of this broken world? You know, those times when it feels like you are going to go under for maybe the last time. Also, we feel sin's cold grip on us. We feel that cold grip when we're maybe suffering from things like having a cold heart because of the criticism and injustice we feel, and it makes us angry and it makes us bitter. We also know how jealousy and lust can damage ourselves and others. We also know how self-centeredness can shut down our relationships. Our secret sins freeze us, and they leave us helpless. We don't think that we can change or escape. But that's why the message of the gospel is so powerful, because it clearly says, yes, there are some icy waters that are too deadly for us to escape. But in the face of such real need, we know that even our best efforts aren't going to work. We need more than just glimpses of compassion. We need more than our best efforts. We need God's love and compassion, full strength, to come to our rescue. And the good news is that it does come to us full strength in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Into life's eternally icy waters, someone had to jump for you and me, and somebody did. Jesus Christ, our Savior, he jumped into the water and he saved us. He lifted us out of the icy depths of sin and despair. He sacrificed his own life on the cross. And his compassion was the most inconvenient there ever could have been, because his compassion was a total giving of himself for you. He showed mercy to forgive you, bind up your wounds, care for you, and then walk with you all the way to heaven. The parable of the Good Samaritan, the focus isn't just to be on how we should be like the Samaritan. The focus is also on how we are like the injured guy on the side of the road. We are wounded because of our sin and others' sin. We struggle with the brokenness of this world, but our Savior Jesus, he's on the road too, and he sees us, and he comes to us. He binds up our wounds, he forgives us, he heals us, he strengthens us, he guides us, he gives us peace, and he gets us back on the road that we know is going to end in heaven. So, why don't we today flex our faith muscles in Jesus and dedicate ourselves to once again, at all times, show the love of Jesus to others? All times, and we can't perfectly do that, but we ask for God's help. Think about some times in life now. We're not on the road from Jerusalem to Jericho. We're not in that time. But maybe we were rushing to get to church today. Maybe tomorrow we'll be rushing to get to work. When we're on those roads, how can we show the love of Jesus to others? We can be patient with our kids when they're not cooperating. When we get to work, we can choose to have a positive, loving attitude. And in doing so, we can be a blessing to others. Let's think about the road of marriage. How can we show the love of Jesus on that road? We can be the gentle and nurturing spirit for our spouse when they really need it. We can be faithful and have integrity. Let's think about the road of aging. How can we show the love of Jesus when we're on that road? We can be kind to our caregivers. We can put aside the frustration, the disappointment, and the sadness that comes because things aren't the way that they used to be. And instead, we can, with God's help, choose to shine forth with His light into this world. Let's think about the road of the National Youth Gathering in Minneapolis. How can we show the love of Jesus on that road? Well, every person we meet, we can love them because Jesus loves them. Let's think about the road of great personal challenges. How can we show the love of Christ when we're on that road? Well, it depends on the challenge, but let me give you a few examples. How about the road of a destructive habit that has taken over our life? We can trust in Jesus. We can turn for strength and forgiveness. How about the road of sadness and disappointment? We can believe and trust in Jesus that He has a plan for us, even if our world has totally fallen apart. How about the road of giving in to the world around us and our own desires? We can turn back to Jesus when we feel like straying. He invites us to follow Him. Rising up to meet the challenge of living lives that share God's love in Christ when others need it the most. That's a life of purpose, of passion, realized potential. But even more than that, that's also a life that points others to the true Good Samaritan who saw us on the side of the road and who forgave us and who loves us and who gives us strength and peace. Thank you, God, for the compassion you have had on us. Help us to share that compassion and love with others. Amen. We have an opportunity now to give our gifts and offerings to Jesus. And when we do that, please, if you feel comfortable, fill out an attendance card in a seat pocket around you. And if you feel comfortable, write some prayer requests on those attendance cards if you have any specific requests, and we'd love to pray for you and with you. Great. At this time, I invite the National Youth Gathering group to come forward, and we're going to stand right here on both sides of the center here by the communion rail. And we are commissioning you for our one-week trip. Okay, and so we're a group of nine, and looking around the rail here, I'm just so thankful for all the ways that you have served the church as we've been raising funds and doing different things. And really my prayer is for all of you to have just a great faith experience. During these past months, you have shared your time and gifts, grown in relationship with one another, and grown in your understanding of the wider church, many of whom you will meet in these coming days. While you are gone, will you continue to love, encourage, and care for each other as members of God's family? Will you represent your parents and our congregation in a God-pleasing fashion and share his love with those you meet? If so, youth, say yes. Okay, we are blessed to have Aaron Stipp be an adult leader with myself, with the gathering group. And Aaron, I ask you, and also this question is for me. Well, first of all, I want to describe a little bit your role, and that is that adult leaders of our young people are a special blessing to all of us. You have cared for our youth, and you have nurtured their faith. You have prayed for them and encourage them. We thank you for your commitment to serve. And now, as you prepare to leave, we commend these young people into your care. And Aaron, as well as myself, will we continue to love and guide these youth at the gathering and beyond? If so, we get to answer yes. Yes. Dear friends, the youth now again, as you meet other Lutheran Christians at the gathering and interact with many other people throughout the city of Minneapolis, will you extend the Christian love and friendship of life in Christ to all that you meet? If so, say yes. Yes. Okay. And this question now is to a larger congregation. And so parents, family members, church family, and friends, you have supported this group and helped them prepare for the gathering. Will you pray for them while they're gone, asking God to fill them with his Holy Spirit, enabling them to celebrate in his name? And so, congregation, if you will pray for the gathering group and you send your love and support to them, I ask you to now say yes.
Yes.
Okay. Let us pray together. Lord, you have called us to be your people by the power of the Holy Spirit in our baptism, and through Jesus Christ, give us our confession of faith. We give thanks for your gracious love and mercy, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the community we share with each other through Jesus, our fortress. And now I ask the congregation to respond, hear our prayer. So, Lord, in your mercy, we commend these loved ones into your care as they travel. Watch over and protect them. When they arrive in Minneapolis, we give them opportunity to grow in their faith and strengthen them in understanding your love for them. Direct them to see and experience your love in all that they do. Empower them to do the work of Jesus for the benefit of others with confidence, conviction, and joy. Lord, in your mercy, we give you thanks and praise for the opportunities ahead of these youth and adults as they gather in Minneapolis. When it is time to return, bring each one safely home to us, enriched by their experiences. Lord, in your mercy. And now receive our Lord's benediction for you, gathering group, as we will be heading off to Minneapolis tomorrow. So as we do that, in all that we do, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. And you can head on back to your seats. So thank you so much. It's an exciting thing coming up, and we also have another church thing that we need to do this morning, is that we have a couple of good church gentlemen that will be joining our board of elders, and so if you guys could come on forward, we will do the installation of a couple new elders. And so we have Carl Kerstetter and John Key have agreed to be part of our elder group here at Life in Christ. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, Holy Scripture tells us that the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, "It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the Word." And Carl and John, you have been chosen and have been called to specific positions of responsibility in our congregation. And as such, you are to work with all of the leadership and all of the congregation, that our life together in Christ may be orderly and pleasing in His sight. You are to see that the services of God's house are held at the proper times, in accordance with the order of our church, that the Word of God is purely preached and taught according to the Lutheran confessions, that the sacraments of Christ are administered according to His institution, that provision is made for the Christian instruction of young and old, that the erring are admonished, and that discipline is maintained. You are to see that the temporal affairs of the congregation are properly administered, and that proper support is provided for the workers of this congregation. You to assist in caring for the poor and the sick, and for your flocks, in cultivating harmony among the members, in promoting the general welfare of the congregation, and in furthering the kingdom of Christ here and throughout the world. While holiness of life and work is the way of all who trust in Christ, it is especially important that you, as office bearers, as elders in this church, show yourselves by word and example to be patterns of good works and Christian devotion. In the presence of God and of this congregation, I therefore ask you, do you accept the office of elder entrusted to you? And do you promise faithfully to carry out your duties, trusting in the Lord, in conforming yourself to His word in accordance with the faith of the Evangelical Lutheran Church? If so, Carl and John, answer, I do.
I do.
Carl, John, I place you as elders of Life in Christ congregation in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Almighty and Most Merciful God of our Heavenly Father, enlighten and strengthen you in your office, that you may be good and faithful stewards to the glory of His name and the good of His people. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give thanks that you have raised up these servants for work among your people. We humbly implore you to grant them, by your Holy Spirit, those gifts which they need for the faithful carrying out of their tasks, most especially wisdom, strength, and willing hearts. Let your blessing rest on this congregation, strengthen the faith, quicken the love, and enkindle the zeal of its members, that your name may be glorified, and that here and in all places under heaven, the kingdom of your Son may be advanced. We pray all these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, and so Carl and John, go in the name of the Lord, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for your labor in the Lord is not in vain. The Almighty and Most Merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless you this day and forevermore. Amen. Okay, thank you so much, and you guys can head on back to your seats. Congregation is invited to rise for prayer. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, you reign in eternal majesty and glory. We praise you for coming into your world through your Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from bondage to sin. Give us your Holy Spirit so that we would trust your word and look to you as our Lord. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, give your aid and blessing to the youth and adults traveling to Minneapolis for the National Youth Gathering. May they be renewed in their faith through this celebration of your mighty power to save and your presence with your people. Lord, in your mercy, guard us, O Lord, against all those who cause strife, whose acts of violence and terror threaten people everywhere. Bless all police, firefighters, and emergency personnel who work on our behalf. Lord, in your mercy. God, look with favor upon all those who are ill, the lonely, the depressed, and the recovering. God, especially this morning, we lift up in prayer Jack and Lucille Beyer, Harold Doty, Dick Randall, Betty Landis, Kevin Speck, Dina Speck's sister Renee, Tammy Frankfurther, Larry Adams, Anita Crawford, Perry Hackler, Steve Bragg, Robert and Marilyn Neiman's granddaughter Ruby, Joe Burdowski and her family at the loss of her sister, Larry Anger, Eric Anderson, Devin Keady and his family at the loss of Grandma Nancy, Bob Bingfort's brother Scott. God, we also pray a prayer for our elders, a prayer of thanksgiving that you have called men into this service and you have led them through this service. And God, as we add two new elders today, we pray for your blessing on the Board of Elders moving forward. We also pray for all those on our 516 list and all those who are wounded beside the road of life in need of help. Give them patience in their afflictions and faith in your sufficient grace that they may be kept through the day of trouble and brought with us at last to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy. Dear God, keep our hearts from greed, that we may joyfully support your church and those who serve us in your name. Keep us from pride of heart that delights more in what we do than what you have done, that we might be your people. Accept with our thanksgiving and praise the tithes and offerings we bring this day. Lord, in your mercy. Taught by our Lord, we confidently pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive with joyful and peace-filled hearts our Lord's benediction for you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Please be seated for our...
Thank you.
announcements before we head out. This Friday is the day when the Life in Christ has a group that is going to serve a meal for the homeless. And so there's a table between the sanctuary and the Christian Life Center where there's more information about that. I'm very excited to show the love of Jesus in that way. Also, as we mentioned and as you saw during the service, the National Youth Gathering Group is leaving tomorrow afternoon. We're going to be gone for a week. And so please pray for the group. Pray for all the youth. There'll be about 20 to 25,000 youth there in Minneapolis. Pray that this is a good time of faith, growth, and fun. And God's blessings be with you all this week.